सहनाभवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुरेव परब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। भवानी शंकरो वंदे श्रद्धा विश्वासरूपिणौ याभ्यां विना न पश्यन्ति सिद्धा स्वान्तस्तमीश्वरम्। रामाय रामभद्राय रामचंद्राय वेदसे रघुनाथाय नाथाय सीतायाः पतये नमः। शंकरं शंकराचार्यं केशवं बादरायणं सूत्रभाष्यकृतौ वंदे भगवन्तौ पुनः पुनः। श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं शंकरं लोकशंकरं। सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां। ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिबोधितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम्। अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं। नमोस्तु ते व्यासविशालबुद्धे फुल्लारविन्दायतपत्रनेत्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्नपारिजाताय तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दुग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्ससुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं। यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः स्तुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनो यस्यान्तं न विदुः सुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः, देवाय तस्मै नमः। ॐ नमः शिवाय, 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 ॐ नमः शिवाय। नमः पार्वती पतये हर हर महादेव। हरि ओम। टुडे इज़ अ वेरी ऑस्पिशियस डे। वी आर ऑल सेलिब्रेटिंग भगवान श्री आदिशंकराचार्य जी'स जयंती। ही वॉज born many, many years ago, according to the records, in the four mathas which Bhagwan had established. He was born in 509 BC and lived up till 477 BC. Though the modern historians, they have a different date to tell, but traditionally we all believe in this date, which is recorded in the mathas. And the four mathas or five mathas which Bhagwan Shankaracharya ji had established, the list of all the mathadhipatis are present there. So Shankaracharya ji was born as avatar of Bhagwan Shiva only. Dakshinamurti, Bhagwan as Lord Shiva, took avatar as Adi Shankaracharya to, again as Bhagwan takes avatar, to establish dharma, to destroy the evil. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma sansthapanarthaya, to protect the good, to destroy the evil, and to establish dharma. The evils whom Bhagwan Shankaracharya ji destroyed were the negative thoughts of people, misunderstanding about the scriptures, misunderstanding about what the real import of the Upanishad, the Bhagavad Gita, the Brahma Sutra, and all the scriptures were. They were thoroughly misunderstood by people, and because of this misunderstanding, people used to follow all wild and confusing paths. So Shankaracharyaji, by commenting on all the scriptures, on the Prasthantrayi, the Upanishads, the Bhagavad Gita, the Brahma Sutra, Bhagavan Sri Adi Shankaracharyaji destroyed the evils of wrong thinking and wrong concept and the wild Rakshasas which are there in the form of erroneous philosophies, destroyed them and re-established Dharma, protecting all those sincere seekers who want to follow the path of spirituality. So protecting the seekers, destroying the negative concepts and re-establishing Dharma, Bhagwan fulfilled his avatar in this Kali Yuga. So very auspicious, and even now we are studying Bhagwan Shankaracharya's work and benefiting from the same. More about this we will see later. Now we will continue with our class on Srimad Bhagavad Gita. So we saw Arjuna, when he came on the battlefield, he got thoroughly confused. His confusion was twofold. Basic was, he was confused regarding the nature of the self. And this confusion is universal. Everyone, most of us, we are confused about the nature of our own self. And Arjuna was also confused regarding his duty, what exactly he should do. And this confusion led to sorrow, to grief. The immediate solution for this is something or other we do in this world. But here Bhagwan is not giving us the immediate but absolute solution to eradicate the confusion and grief completely. Atyantika dukkha nivrutti and paramananda prapti, it is called. Means removing the sorrow completely along with its cause and giving supreme joy to all. That can be done only through self-knowledge. The role of karma upasana is to prepare us for self-knowledge. But once the self-knowledge is gained, we transcend all karma, we transcend all upasanas and gain abidance in that self. So Bhagavan tells Arjuna that, oh Arjuna, you don't have to grieve for these people because the Atma is eternal. Atma never dies. You never die. I don't die. All these people don't die. We always existed before. We are existing now. And we will always exist in future. There is no death for Atma. The bodies keep on changing. As long as these karmas are there, we keep on taking different, assuming different bodies, and they keep on changing. But even when the body changes, the Atma remains unaffected, unchanged. Just like the space remains unaffected by all the activities happening in space, by all the structures which we build in space and destroy, the space remains same. The space in which we are moving, in the same space our forefathers also moved, and the great dinosaurs also moved. The space has remained same. The structures have come and gone, space has remained same. Similarly, Atma remains same. So as you move towards Atma Jnana, you will face lot of challenges, lot of joys and sorrows. Bhagwan says you bear with them, develop titiksha, forbearance, and you will become fit to attain that self-realization. Also, when you look at this world which you see is constantly changing. Everything, whatever we are aware of through the senses, including the senses, through the mind, including the mind, through the intellect, including the intellect, all that we know, all that we are aware of, changes constantly. So this changing phenomena is called asat. Changing existence, it exists all the time. There was never a time when world becomes non-existent. World always exists. And the Lord of the world also always exists. Ishvara is real. The world is also real. Ishvara existed before, is existing now, it exists in future. The world also exists. Only thing, the world undergoes change. The world gets created, it is sustained, and again get dissolved. Even when it is dissolved, potentially it exists. So Bhagwan says, looking at this world as asat, as temporary, as changing, don't get deluded, don't get disturbed. You keep moving on your path of spirituality, because that sat doesn't change. And what is that sat? Bhagavan says that sat is avinashi, indestructible, and it pervades everything. Ena sarvam idam tatam. Vinasham avyayasyasya nakaschit kartum arhati. The destruction of this sat is not possible to do by anyone. This sat atma can never be destroyed. It is indestructible. Even Ishvara cannot destroy. But these bodies and this world are antavantaha. Means when we look at them in the state of ignorance, we feel that they have a separate existence, that they are something different from the Supreme Reality. But when we come to understand the Supreme, then a strange thing happens, that the world disappears and what we see as world is nothing but that Brahma alone. Brahma alone is seen everywhere. Just like a person who is looking at ornaments, gold ornaments, and doesn't know the nature of gold, have not recognized gold, will look at the ornaments as ornaments. But when he comes to understand gold, suddenly he will see that there is only gold. All the ornaments have their separate existence, have just disappeared. Only gold and gold alone is there. Similarly, Bhagavan says, this gross physical body, the subtle body, and all this phenomenal world is antavantaha, comes to an end when the right understanding takes place. So, this Atma is nirvikari. It doesn't undergo any change, any modification. Bhagavan says, it doesn't perform any action and no action can be performed on the Atma. He says, ya enam vetti hantaram yaschenam manyate hatam ubhav tau na vijanitah nayam hanti na hanyate. That this Atma doesn't kill anyone, nor does it get killed. Those who think that they are killing someone and those who think they are getting killed, Bhagavan says both of them don't know the nature of that Atma. उभौ तौ न विजानीतः नायं हन्ति न हन्यते. सो आत्मा इज निर्विकार, निर्विकारी. निर्विकारी मीन्स फ्री फ्रॉम ऑल मॉडिफिकेशन. हाउ इट इज निर्विकारी? दैट भगवान नाउ रिवील्स इन द नेक्स्ट वर्स, वर्स नंबर 20, चैप्टर 2. ही सेज न जायते म्रियते वा कदाचिद् नायं भूत्वा भविता वा न भूयः अजो नित्यशाश्वतोऽयं पुराणः न हन्यते हन्यमाने शरीरे. भगवान सेज दिस आत्मा न जायते. दिस आत्मा इज नेवर बॉर्न. There is no birth for Atma. Na mriyate, it never dies. There is no death for Atma. Va kadachit, never. Na ayam bhutva bhavitava na bhuyaha. Na ayam bhutva, having become, having taken birth, it doesn't become non-existent, it doesn't disappear. That is what we call death. Something is present and then become absent. That we call death. Having come into existence, something goes into non-existent, means it disappears from our vision. That we call as death. And something which was not there comes into existence, that we call birth. So such death and birth is not there for Atma. Na ayam bhutva, this Atma having become, doesn't become non-existence. Nor does it go into, nor was it non-existent and then becomes existent. So there is no birth, there is no death for the Atma. Therefore it is ajaha. It is ajah, unborn, nityah, eternal, shashvatah. Shashvat also means eternal, everlasting. Ayam puranah. Purana means is always new. Pura api navam means even in the past it was new. Now it is new. And in future also it will remain new. It is always new. It is always present. Na hanyate hanyamane sharire. It doesn't get killed, destroyed when the body is destroyed. See, therefore, the Atma is indicated as nirvikari, free from all modification. See, all that we see in this world undergoes various modifications. Like our own physical body, it undergoes sixfold modification. It's called asti, jayate, vardate, viparinamate, apakshiyate, vinashyati. Iti, six. How do we take birth in this body? So first the person comes into existence, or it takes up this body in the mother's womb. See, according to our karma, we get our body. Human body, animal, bird, plant, whatever bodies we get it according to our karma. So in a lifetime, when we perform actions, all our actions get recorded, and based on our actions, we get the future birth, good, bad, ugly. We also can go to some other lokas. So all depends on the karma. If a person gains lot of punya karma, that person goes to Swarga. Bhakshine punye martilokam vishanti. But when the punya is over, again comes back on this martilok. in this world of death. So, how does this process begin? That when we die and when we are born again, according to our karma, we enter the body of our mother, of our father, then our mother. So the mother's, in the mother's womb, I take up that body. And then it starts growing. Then others say, oh, that lady is pregnant, that child is there. So I exist, that person exists in the mother's womb, but not has not taken birth yet in this world. So that is the first change which happens when we take up the body. That's called asti, that I exist in the mother's womb. Potentially, the person is present in the mother's womb. That's called asti. That's the first change which body takes in the body, it takes place. Then after the specific time, the child is born. Then we say, has taken birth. So jayate, the child is born. Jayate, everyone comes to know about the child. One can see the child, then give some name to the child. So the child is born. We are born in this body. Then the body keeps on growing. We keep on eating, drinking, and the body keeps on growing. In mother's womb, it was so tiny little. Then by the time the 9 month is over, it becomes fully grown. Then it is born and again it continues to grow. That's called vardhate. It grows, grows and grows in all directions. Vardhate. And later on, as it grows, it also viparinamate. It undergoes some changes, some modification. So sometimes certain growth is there on some limb more than some other limb, it is less. So different modification takes place. Viparinamate. So asti jayate vardhate viparinamate. And then it reaches a particular period in its growth, and then slowly the disintegration of the body takes place. As we grow old, the body starts slowly disintegrating. The cells are not created as vigorously as they were before. All the organs start becoming weak. The body starts becoming weak. New cells are not born, and slowly disintegration takes place. That's called apakshiyate. It disintegrates. It becomes weak. It moves towards its destruction. And then, when the time is up, the body is dropped. The sukshma sharir drops the body. The atma, which was holding on to this body through the sukshma sharir, drops the body. That is called vinashyati. So this sixfold modification takes place in the body. But these modifications don't happen in atma. In the atma, there are no sixfold modifications. That is what is presented in this shloka. Bhagwan says, na jayate, because it is always present, it is not born. Atma is always present. There is no birth for it. See, something which is absent and born, we say, oh, it has taken birth, but atma is always present. There is no question of birth for that atma. Then there is no destruction for the Atma, na mriyate. And in between all these changes, vardate, viparinamate, apakshiyate, etc. are also negated by saying that Atma is nitya, shashvataha, puranaha. So Atma is ajaha, unborn, is always present. It is nityaha, eternal, shashvataha, everlasting, puranaha, pura api navam. Though it is very ancient, means it was there from beginningless time, but it is always new, always fresh. Atma doesn't become old. Atma doesn't become dilapidated. Atma doesn't grow senile. There is no change in that Atma. So, na jayate mriyate va kadachit nayam bhutva bhavita vana bhuyah ajo nitya shashvato yam puranah na hanyate hanyamane sharire. So, even when the body is cut or destroyed, the Atma doesn't get destroyed. It doesn't get affected at all. Just like we remove our dress, we don't get affected. Our existence doesn't depend on the existence of the dress. Similarly, the existence of that Atma doesn't depend on the existence of the bodies. Therefore, hey Arjuna, knowing the nature of Atma in this way, you fight this war. You fulfill whatever duties you have, you just fulfill them. So thus, in this verse, Bhagwan tells about the nirvikar nature of that Atma. Shankaracharya ji, he writes, ki asmin mantre shad bhava vikaraha laukika vastu vikriya atmani pratishidhyante. The shad vikar which we see, the sixfold modification which we see in the worldly objects, they are negated in the Supreme Atma. So now Bhagwan concludes this topic of that Atma is nirvikar and it is not the doer of any action nor the propeller of any action. He says in the next verse, Veda vinashinam nityam yaenam ajam avyayam katham sapurushah partha kam ghatayati hantikam. Bhagavan says, Veda avinashinam nityam. Veda, one who knows, vijanati, one who recognizes, one who knows this Atma enam. Enam, this Atma of this particular, this all these lakshanas, one who comes to realize this Atma. As I said, we know our own presence, but we are unaware of our real nature. That is the problem. Many times in the scriptures, they give example of a person, a cowherd boy. He happened to see a shining stone as he had taken the cows for grazing. He saw a shining stone. So he liked it. So he picked it up and he tied it in a cloth and tied it around the neck of a calf. And he was just moving around. Then one person from the city, he came and he observed this cowherd boy and this cows, and that he saw that shining stone. And he recognized that, oh, this stone is not an ordinary stone. but it is diamond. So he told that cowherd boy that, please, can you just give me that stone or sell me that stone? So cowherd boy was surprised why he is interested in stone. There must be some ulterior motive behind him. So he said, no, I will not sell you. Then that cowherd boy, he wondered, and he took that stone to different people to find out exactly what it is and why it is so important. So he showed it to a vegetable vendor that what is this and how much you will give me for the stone. The vendor said, oh, it's ordinary stone, I will give you just 5 rupees or something. Then he went to another grocery store. He said, I will give you more money. Then he approached many different people. Finally, he went to a person who knew about gems, knew about stones, who knew the value of stones. And he showed it to him, and that person said, this is diamond, uncut diamond. But it is most valuable, one of the hardest substance, natural substance on earth, and very, very valuable. I cannot tell you how much money it is worth. So when that boy heard this, he was very amazed. All the time he had that stone with him, but he did not know the value. Now he knew the value. Suddenly that stone became invaluable to him. Similarly, all of us, we are aware of our own existence, but we don't know our value. People give us our value depending on our body, on our mind, on our wealth, on our position. People respect you. Sometimes we wonder why they are respecting me. Then you come to know they are respecting me because I have a position, I have a name, I have some wealth. When that wealth goes away, people also leave you and go away. Once the position goes away, people also leave and go away. Yavad vitto parjana saktah, tavan nija parivaro raktah. Paschat jivati jarjar dehe vartam kopina pruchyati gehe. As long as we give something to the world, they respect, they value us. Once we stop that, they don't have any respect for us. So we are judged, we judge ourselves, we evaluate ourselves, and we evaluate the world, or the world also evaluate us, depending on our dress, on our body, on our wealth, on our name, on our education, on our lineage. But all these values are invaluable, are totally useless in front of the real value which I have for myself. The Atma is invaluable. The Atma is Sakshat Brahma. Aham Brahmasmi Mano Buddhi Ahankara Chittani Naham Nacha Shrotra Jivve Nacha Ghrana Netre Nacha Vyoma Bhumir Na Tejo Na Vayuhu Chidananda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. I am that Shiva, I am that Sakshat Brahma. I am not this body, mind, intellect, the senses and the world. I am that Supreme Brahma. So the scriptures, the teacher, shows us our real value. The world devalues us. The world doesn't know our value. And we also don't know our value. So we have to understand the Atma is with us all the time, but its value have to be understood with the help of the scriptures. Even if somebody says that you are a great person, that is not so great in front of the teacher who says that you are Brahma. Even if somebody says that you are like God, you are the very master of this world, that is also very, very less in front of the statement that you are Brahma, in front of the fact that you are Brahma. So, one who knows, Bhagavan says, Veda. Veda is a very powerful word here. One who knows. Knows means not just has collected data, not just has collected some information. Knows means directly have realized it. Not through the senses, not through the mind, not through the intellect, but directly in the state of meditation, we come to know ourselves as we are. Dhyanavastita tadgatena manasa pashyanti yam yoginaha. Yogis see the Supreme Self by taking their mind in dhyanavastha. Just like we want to know the taste of an object, of a substance, of a eatable object, we cannot know it just by touching it, by looking at it, by smelling it. The real taste we can experience only by touching it with our tongue. Similarly, the real taste of yourself you will know only by going into meditation. In the Turiya Avastha, we come to recognize, oh, I am soham, soham hamsaha, I am that Supreme Self. Nehananasti kinchana, in me there are no divisions. Aham brahmasmi, I am that Sakshat Brahma. So Bhagavan says, Veda, avinashinam, one who knows that Atma is avinashi, indestructible, that it doesn't get destroyed. 100% one knows, not just theoretically. If theoretically we know, then we will get frightened of life and death. But if we really know, then there is no fear of death. Because Atma is deathless, avinashi. So Veda avinashinam, nityam, it is eternal. Ya enam ajam, it is unborn. Atma is unborn. There is no birth in Atma. Unborn. Avyayam. No change, no modification happens in that Atma. Avyayam. So such a person who recognizes this Atma in this way, Bhagavan says, Katham sa purusha partha kam ghatayati hanti kam. These are rhetorical questions Bhagavan is asking. That one who knows that Atma is eternal, how can that person propel someone to be killed or kill someone? Katham sa purusha partha kam ghatayati hantikam, whom will he kill? Whom will he propel to be killed? Instigate to be killed? Means there is no doership in that nirvikari Atma. Atmanah avikriyatvam sarva karma sambhava karana visheshah. So there is no vikar in that Atma. So how can this person have this sense of doership that I am killing someone, or I am making someone kill someone, or I am being killed? Here the Bhagavan gives killing and all as an example only, but this is applicable to all different types of action. So a person who recognizes this Atma, even knows it theoretically in this way, such a person becomes free of this sense of doership, and for such a person the only duty will be to gain that abidance in the Supreme Self. Shankaracharya ji has written an elaborate commentary on this verse to convey the right meaning of this verse, how when a person knows about this, Atma becomes free of the sense of doership and enjoyership. So Shastra Acharya Upadesha Shama Damadi Sanskritam Mana Atma Darshane Karanam. Bhagwan says that the mind which has gained the proper understanding of the Shastra through the Acharya, through the teacher, and also developed the qualities like Shama, Dama, etc., such a mind becomes fit to directly recognize that self, to gain that direct experience of that self. See, as I said, Vedanta has got these three steps to gain that supreme state of enlightenment: Shravan, Manan, and Nididhyasan. All these three steps are very important. So through Shravan we come to know about this nature of the self. When we listen to the scriptures from a knowledgeable master, we come to understand the nature of the self. Every one of us, we know I am, but all of us, we don't know that I am Brahma. So when I listen to the teacher, listen to the scripture, the teacher tells me that, oh my dear disciple, you are Brahma, Tattvam Asi. There's a very beautiful Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad. In that Upanishad, there is a story of Shvetaketu. Shvetaketu was a son of a great rishi. And he was a little boy of 12 years, but was not going to the school or something, Gurukul. So his father tells him that in our lineage no one has remained uneducated, so you go to this Gurukul and learn. So he goes to some other teacher, he stays there for 12 years, learns the scriptures and comes back. But when he comes back with lot of pride, lot of arrogance, that I know everything now, I am a very learned person. So the father notices his son, that this fellow has gone to study but has not, I don't think he has learnt anything. So he asks him that, oh my dear son, did you study everything? He said, yes, I know everything now. So the father asked him, hey Shvetaketu, do you know that knowing which everything becomes known? Do you know that one thing, knowing which everything becomes known? So Shvetaketu was stunned, like he had never asked and never heard about this. So he said, oh my dear father, I don't know this. I don't know whether my teacher knew about it, but I don't know about it. And then suddenly he realized that he doesn't really know. Though he had learnt a lot, but he has missed the essential teaching. So he knew that his father knows about it, so he surrenders to his father and tells him, request him that you please teach me what is that one thing knowing which everything becomes known. So his father starts teaching him. The father tells him that this world which you see is the effect of that supreme Brahma, which is the cause. Just like from a clay, all the pots are created. Similarly, from that Brahma, this world has come. Everything is the expression of that Brahma. And then the father says, you are that Brahma. Tat tvam asi Shvetaketu. Hey Shvetaketu, that Brahma you are. Shvetaketu was stunned, like he had never heard this before. He just couldn't believe. And he requested his father, please explain this to me again. I am not comprehending this. I have been living with this thought that I am this body, I am born, I will die, and suddenly now I hear that I am that Brahma, which is all pervading, which is the very essence of this whole world. I don't understand this. Please teach me again. So his father teaches him again, giving some other example. Again, Shvetaketu says that, oh, please teach me again. So father teaches him again. So in this way, father teaches him 9 times, giving 9 different examples. And every time he says, Tattvamasi Shvetaketu. This Tattvamasi is a very famous Mahavakya, which is there in this Chandogya Upanishad. So the Shvetaketu comes to understand this. He meditates on that and gain that abidance in this supreme truth. So we have to hear about it, Shravan. We have to contemplate and understand. Just hearing itself is not everything. We have to understand this simple statement, but profound statement, that I am Brahma. I am Atma Brahma. I am Atma means this Atma. This I, which I am experiencing in this body, is really Brahma. But first we should be able to separate this I from Ahankar. Separate this I from Mana Buddhi Chitta. Separate this I from our body and locate that I and understand that I as Brahma. I am Atma Brahma. So when we are convinced beyond all doubt that I am Brahma, then I have to meditate and assert that I am Brahma. This is the path of Nididhyasana. This is the path of Jnana. This is what we call Nivritti Marga. The Nididhyasana, to drop all other activities, to drop all other engagements, and just focus our attention on gaining that firm abidance in our Supreme Self, Aham Brahmasmi. It's very fascinating. Shravan is wonderful. 1,000 times more wonderful is Mananam, but infinite time more wonderful is Nididhyasana. Through Nididhyasana only we gain the Supreme state of realization. So Bhagavan says, one who knows that Atma in this way, as Avinashi, as indestructible, as Nityam, as Enam Ajam, as unborn, Avyayam, free from all modifications and change, such a person becomes at that very moment, becomes free of the sense of doership and enjoyership. Becomes free from that wrong notion that I am the doer of action. See, just like our mobile, lot of activity happen within the mobile. When we make a call, or when we type something, when we send messages, when we operate our mobile, lot of internal things keep on happening. But all these things are happening within the mobile, within the system itself. We are just propelling it. We are just giving it some, what you call, some input, and the whole system functions. It is internally everything is happening. Similarly, all the activities are happening within the prakriti. Prakritim kriyamanani gunais sarvani. By the gunas of the prakriti, all the actions are being performed. Everything is performed by the gunas of prakriti. Ahankara vimhuda atma karta aham iti manyate. Bhagavan says, out of foolishness, ignorance, the ignorant person thinks he is the doer. Atma is not the doer. The body, mind, intellect, they function according to the laws of prakriti. So one who knows this, Veda vinashinam nityam katham yainam ajam avyam katham sa purusha partha kam ghatayati hantikam, such a person, how will he propel someone to commit any, how can he propel someone to kill, and how he himself will kill? Means, how will he perform any action, or how can he make anybody else perform any action? Because no activity happens in the self. So it's the most beautiful shloka. More about this we will see in our class tomorrow. But now we will just chant some few stotras in praise of Bhagwan Sri Adi Shankaracharya. All that we are learning now is because of the grace of Adi Shankaracharya. He was Sakshat Avatar of Bhagwan, Lord Shiva. If Shankaracharya ji was not born, then I don't think we would have ever understood Hinduism. We would have ever understood our Sanatan Dharma. We should all be very, very grateful to Adi Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya's commentaries are invaluable. See, we have the ultimate praman to understand ourselves. The praman are the Vedas, the Upanishads, the Bhagavad Gita, the Brahma Sutra. They are the prasthantrai. To understand who am I have to go through this prasthantrai. But before that, the path of pravritti, we have so many other texts which also help us in the path of pravritti. The Vedas are there, the Puranas are there, the Mahabharata is there, the Ramayana is there. So many texts are there which help us on the path of pravritti, as well as then they help us on the path of nivritti. But it is not very easy to comprehend this text. This is made possible by the great blessings which we have received from Adi Shankaracharya. So Shankaracharya ji, as I said, was born in the year 509 BC, before Christ. Generally, the modern historians and the Western historians, they try to bring the date of his birth more closer and closer, and after the birth of Jesus Christ. But traditionally, as we have the records in all our mathas, he was born 509 BC and he lived for 32 years. Bhagwan took sannyas at the age of 8 or so. He left his home and he went in search of his teacher. He met Govinda Padacharya ji, and he learned from Govinda Padacharya all the scriptures. And he started writing commentaries. It is said first he wrote commentary on Vishnu Sahasranam, Beautiful commentary is there by Shankaracharya ji on Vishnu Sahasranam. In this commentary, he quotes the scriptures, other scriptures. So many scriptures he has quoted, the Puranas and the Mahabharata and the Upanishads. So he had knowledge of all the scriptures. Therefore we say, Shruti Smriti Purana Nam Alayam Karuna Alayam. Namami Bhagavat Padam Shankaram Loka Shankaram. He had the knowledge of all the scriptures. So he wrote the commentary on the Vishnu Sahasranam. His teacher was very, very fascinated, and the teacher told him that you write commentaries on the Upanishads, you write commentaries on Gita and Brahma Sutra also. So Bhagwan started writing commentaries on all these texts. And simultaneously he moved all over the country. He went length and breadth of the country 2-3 times. And he wrote commentaries. Most fascinating. See, if you just read the commentaries of Bhagwan Shankaracharya of the Gita Upanishad, 10 Upanishads and Brahma Sutra, it will take about 108 hours to read. It was done. People do it. Parayana of Shankaracharya ji's Bhashya, it takes 108 hours at a normal pace to chant, just to chant the commentary. So just imagine the vastness. But the beauty of his commentary is that it is prasanna gambhir, it is very pleasant, very deep, and most important, there are no contradictions. Bhagwan is absolutely clear about what he is conveying. And he is not conveying his own thing. He says that I am just telling you what the scriptures are telling. But his commentaries don't have any, what you call, any discrepancies in it. There are no contradictions in his commentary. Every line and every word which he has uttered is very, very valuable. Because Bhagwan was Sakshat Avatar of Bhagwan only. Shiva Bhagwan, who is our Adi Guru, himself had taken avatar as Adi Shankaracharya. So Shankaracharya's commentary is invaluable in order to understand Vedanta properly. Otherwise there are misunderstanding. People have written commentaries on the Upanishads, they have written commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita, and most of that commentaries have so many contradictions. They say one thing at one place, say something else at another place. So total confusion is there. But if you read and study properly under a proper guide, the commentaries of Bhagwan Shankaracharya ji, you will have no confusion on this path of spirituality. So it's a strong weapon to destroy the false concept of our own mind and the false concept which is there in this world. See, when Bhagwan Krishna took avatar, he came into this world and he also protected the sadhus, the good people. He destroyed the evil. And he also established dharma. And he destroyed everyone with the help of his Sudarshan Chakra. But when he concluded his avatar, he took his Sudarshan Chakra with him. He didn't give it to somebody else. So later on, when the Durgunis came, he didn't have the Sudarshan Chakra to kill them. When Rama avatar took place, he brought with him his kodand, his dhanush, and his bows, arrows. And his arrows were such that after destroying the enemies, it is to come back to him. But after his avatar, after concluding his avatar, Bhagwan took his kodanda with him. But Bhagwan Shankaracharya ji, Bhagwan's avatar as Shankaracharya ji, he brought the weapon of his bhashya to destroy the evils of this world. Actually, our evils are there in our head. If that gets destroyed, the whole world will become very peaceful and happy place for everyone to live. Because wrong thinking itself is creating havoc in this world. Misunderstanding, wrong thinking, what you call faulty philosophies are creating havoc in the world. And the only way of setting this right is to use the weapon of Shankaracharya ji, that is his bhashya. If we study his bhashya, make ourselves fit, and then spread the message of his bhashya in this world, that is the best thing we can do to make the whole world peaceful and happy. So it's a most fascinating day where we remember. Actually, we should remember Bhagwan every day, every moment. But today is his Jayanti, and we will chant a few mantras in praise of Bhagwan. There is this very beautiful stotra, which is written by Totakacharya. Shankaracharya ji had many disciples. One of them was Totakacharya. He has written a beautiful ashtakam called Totaka Ashtakam that we will chant. If you have the book with you, you can also chant. We will जय जय शंकर हर हर शंकर 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 विदिताखिल शास्त्र सुधा जलधे महितोपनिषत् कथितार्थ निधे हृदये कलये विमलं चरणम् हृदये कलये विमलं चरणं भवशंकर देशिकमे शरणं भवशंकर देशिकमे शरणं करुणा वरुणालय पालय मां भवसागर दुख विदो नर्दम रचयाखिल दर्शन तत्वविदम रचयाखिल दर्शन तत्वविदम भवशंकर देशिकमे शरणम्। भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भवता जनता सुहिता भविता निज बोध विचारण चारुमते कलयेश्वर जीव विवेक विदं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भव एव भवानिति मे नितरा समजायत चेतसि कौतुकिता मम वारय मोह महाजलधिं मम वारय मोह महाजलधिं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण सुकृते धिकृते बहुधा भवतो भविता समदर्शन लालसता अतिदीनमिमं परिपालय मां भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण जगतीमवितुं कलिता कृतयो विचरन्ति महामहसच्छलतः अहिमांशुरिवात्र विभासि गुरो भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण गुरु पुंगव पुंगव के तनते समतामयताम नहि कोऽपि सुधी शरणागत वत्सल तत्व निधे भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण विदिता न मया विशदैककला न च किंचन कांचनमस्ति गुरु द्रुतमेव विदेहि कृपां सहजां द्रुतमेव विदेहि कृपां सहजां भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण 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 भव शंकर देशिक मे शरण। बोलिए श्री शंकर भगवत्पाद भगवान की जय। ओम न तत्र सूर्यो भाति न चंद्र तारकं नीमा विद्युतो भांति कुतोयम अग्निः तमेव भान्तमनु भाति सर्वं तस्य भासा सर्वमिदं विभाति। बोलिए श्री सद्गुरुनाथ महाराज की जय। शंकर शंकर शंकरा शंकर शंकर शंकरा शंकर शंकर शंकरा शंकरा भयंकरा शंकरा भयंकरा पाहि मां कृपा करा पाहि मां कृपा करा पाहि मां परमेश्वरा पाहि मां जगदीश्वरा शंकर शंकर शंकरा शंकर शंकर शंकरा 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 नमः पार्वती पतये हर हर महादेव जय जय शंकर हर हर शंकर 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 जय जय शंकर हर हर जय शंकर बोलिए श्री शंकर भगवत्पाद भगवान की जय। ओम सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत् असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतंगमय। ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः। हरिः ॐ।